Welcome to this fifth class of our discussion of universal gravitation. In this class, we will be discussing some of the selected questions so that the entire concepts that you have studied, it gets revised. So I will advise you that you keep the H.C. Verma book, Concepts of Physics Part 1, the gravitation chapter in front of you so that you can have the question language in front of you at the time we discuss. So the selected questions we will be discussing. Just observe, from objective 2, I am discussing the question 1. They are saying that if V and E are the gravitational potential and gravitational field at a point, then it is possible to have. They have given 4 options. First option is V is equal to 0 and E is equal to 0. See, this is possible. That is, gravitational field is also 0, potential is also 0, and it is quite natural that there doesn't exist any field and there doesn't exist any potential. So in my opinion, this is possible. The question just asks to identify the possibility of this. Second, they are giving V equal to 0 and E is not equal to 0. That is, we need to identify a location where gravitational potential is 0 while gravitational field exists. Let me tell you that there is no such example where potential is 0. So this is not possible. See, I don't have the answer at present. You may verify, but whatever may be the answer, in my opinion, you can search from other websites also, you can search in other books also. This is not possible because in electrostatics, what happens? The potential may be positive, may be negative, so they nullify. So here, potential is, or it cannot be, 0 if gravitational field exists. So pay attention to this particular option. Then they are saying the gravitational potential is not equal to 0 and gravitational field is equal to 0. Yes, this is possible, and it happens inside a uniform spherical shell. And then they are saying that gravitational potential is not equal to 0 and gravitational field is also not equal to 0. This is normal because field and potential both exists. And therefore, in my opinion, out of these 4 options, option B cannot be accepted. Please see the language of this question. Then let us choose question number 4 from the exercise. They have given that these are 3 uniform spheres of mass M and radius A. They are touching each other. And what we need to find out is the magnitude of the gravitational force on any of the spheres due to the other two. Just consider them as a particle. Let's say that I find out the gravitational force on this particular sphere. So the other two spheres will be pulling it with gravitational force, and we need to find out the resultant gravitational force, where each force will be how much? G into mass of one into mass of the other divided by the distance. Now distance is 2 times A, where A is the radius. Say they, if we join the centers, they form an equilateral triangle that you can very easily understand here. So the angle between them, these two forces, is 60 degree. Therefore, the resultant is nothing but root over F square plus F square plus 2 times F into cos 60 degree. If you put the value of F and work out, you get root over 3 G M square divided by 4 A square as the net force on any one of the spheres due to the other two. Then look at question number 5. In question number 5, they have said that 4 particles, each of mass m, they are moving in circular path and then moving in the circular path, then who will be providing them with the necessary centripetal force? They are moving under the action of their own mutual gravitational attraction. And we need to find out the speed of the particle. See, if you consider a very symmetrical arrangement of these four particles and this is placed at the vertices of the square, the entire square is rotating about this particular center that you can take. So, on each particle, we need to find out the net force. Suppose I take this particle and the forces that are exerted by this other three particles are like this. This will be g m square by a square, where a is each side that we will find out, and then g m square divided by a square, and this one it will be g m square divided by 2r square. Here a is the side of the square. So definitely a square plus a square is equal to diameter square, that is 2r square. So 2a square is equal to 4r square, or a square is equal to 2 times r square. So then what is the net force on this particle? The net force, it will be equal to, see, these two are perpendicular to one another. So therefore, their resultant is root 2 times any one of them. That is root 2 times gm square divided by a square. I am directly writing a square as 2r square. And the other force, this is directly towards the center. Hence, what should be written directly? I am writing it as g m square divided by 4r square. This is what? The net force. And this net force is the basically centripetal force which is required for this particle to move in this type of circular path. Then I am taking g m square by r square common. Root 2 by 2 is 1 by root 2. And this is equal to 1 by 4. And this is nothing but mv square by r. Now, what was to be done? Let us again look at the question. We need to find out the speed of these particles. Okay. So, from there, if you just rearrange these terms, v square we will be getting, and then we will be having that this one m will get cancelled. It is also capital M actually. So 1m will get cancelled, and then we have gm by r, one of the r will also get cancelled, and we have 2 root 2 plus 1 divided by 4 and then take a square root. So this will be the speed of each particle. Then look at question 11. In question 11 they have said a tunnel is dug along the diameter of the earth. See, along the diameter you have made a through and through hole. That is, you started digging from one end of this earth and passing through the center, you make the tunnel to go out from the diametrically opposite end of this earth. Now consider a particle which is at a distance x from the center of this earth. And what was the question? Find the force on this particle whose mass is m, which is placed at this center. Now, what you do is, you consider the earth as a solid sphere. Now, in a solid sphere, what is the gravitational field intensity inside? If I take a point at a distance x, it is nothing but gm by r cube into x. Is it not? And therefore, the force on the particle is nothing but the mass of the particle into gravitational field intensity, that is gmm divided by r cube multiplied by x will be the force, and the force will be acting towards the center of the earth. The particle will be attracted. If you leave the particle there, the particle will start moving towards the center. And it will even bypass the center and go to the other side. And this particular part of the problem, you will be solving in your simple harmonic motion chapter. Now look at question number 12. A tunnel is dug along the chord of the earth at a perpendicular distance r by 2 from the center of the earth, and the wall of the tunnel is assumed to be frictionless, and a particle is kept somewhere inside the tunnel at a distance x from the center of the tunnel. And what we need to find out is, find the force exerted by the wall on the particle whose mass is m and it is at a distance x from the center. Just very easy. What you do is, you simply draw the free body diagram of the particle. You will be able to very easily understand the net force on the particle here. The particle is at this point. So now, without any doubt, we can say that the particle will be attracted towards the center. Is it not? Center of what? Center of this earth. Now, this is basically the weight, the gravitational pull. But it is not on the surface of this earth, mind it. How far it is from the center? It is at a distance which is equal to root over x square plus r square by 4 from the center. Is it not? So, you can draw a triangle. This is the center of this tunnel. So now, the force, this force if I denote by F, this force is equal to G M M by R cube into distance from the center. Do you remember? We have done the gravitational field intensity at a point inside the earth, inside the solid sphere, this force. Now, apart from this force, what will happen that the force will be having two components, is it not? So let us also see the two components of this force. So due to these components, what will happen that this particle will have the tendency to go towards the middle. It will be attracted towards the center of the tunnel. And this component is in this direction. Due to this component of the force, what will happen? Let me denote it by F1 and F2. That due to F1, it will be pressing the wall of the tunnel. So wall of the tunnel will be giving it a normal reaction N. Now again, you see the language of the question. We have to find out the force exerted by the wall on this particle. That means our job is to find out the normal reaction, of the wall on the particle, which is equal to normal reaction, that is F1. Now F1 means, if I take this as angle theta, so F1 is nothing but F sine theta, is it not? So F sine theta, let us try to recognize, F is G m small m divided by R cube into root over x square plus R square by 4, and sine theta, just recognize, sine theta will be equal to R by 2, because this side is R by 2, divided by root over x square plus R square by 4. So very well, we see that the square root term cancels. We have G capital M small m divided by 2 R square. This is the normal reaction force provided by the wall on the particle at that instance. Yeah, if they ask one more thing, if they ask the acceleration, although they have not asked in this question, just see what is the acceleration of this particle. That can be also found out. Acceleration of the particle, it is due to force F2, is it not? So force F2 divided by mass. What is F2? F2 is equal to F cos theta divided by mass. So F, that you can very easily put the value of F, you can recognize what is cos theta. Once you find out this, let's put F is equal to G capital M small m divided by R cube root over x square plus R square by 4. This small m is also there, and cos theta is equal to x divided by root over x square plus R square by 4. Then what will happen? Again, that root goes, small m cancels, gm, and then small m cancels, x will be there, divided by r cube. What is this? This is the acceleration of the particle at that instance. And what you are able to see, that the acceleration is proportional to the distance of the particle from the center of the tunnel, not from the center of the earth, from center of the tunnel. Just observe, the acceleration is proportional to x, and x is the distance of the particle from the center of the tunnel. The same part of the question will be again utilized in your simple harmonic motion chapter. Now look at question number 13. Here they have said in question number 13 that a solid sphere of mass small m and radius small r, which I have shown shaded in the figure, in the main figure in the book also you can refer to, that is placed inside a hollow shell of mass capital M and radius capital R. And this is the point of contact that I have marked. Now this question has three parts. A particle of mass M dash is placed on the line joining the two centers. See this dotted line, I have shown the line joining the two centers. And based on three different parts, we have to find the force of gravitational attraction on this particle of mass M dash if R is less than X less than 2R. R is less than X less than 2R means where the particle is kept. The particle is kept inside the solid sphere. Is it not? Inside the solid sphere. So this hollow sphere will not exert any force. Why? Because inside a hollow sphere, the net field is zero. Hollow sphere will not exert force. So force will be only exerted by the solid sphere. What is the gravitational field inside the solid sphere? If you place the particle here, just see this distance. And this is x. So x is from the point of contact, is it not? X is from the point of contact. So once we are placing this particle at a distance x from the point of contact, its distance from the center will be how much? X minus a small r, is it not? So now g into mass of the solid sphere divided by radius cube into distance from the center, x minus r, is it not, into m dash filled into that mass. I hope you got this idea. Because the hollow sphere will not exert any force. Now, 2r less than x less than 2r, that is we are placing it somewhere here. If you place somewhere here, again the same story, hollow sphere will not exert force. Then who will exert force? Only the solid sphere. And this point is outside the solid sphere. How much? G into mass of the solid sphere into mass of that particle divided by distance square, distance from the center. Now distance from the point of contact is x. So distance from the center of the solid sphere up to that particular point, I am talking about this distance, is x minus r. So this will be x minus r whole square. And again, if you work out the third point, here they are saying that x is greater than 2r. X is greater than 2r means you are putting it here. Both will exert force. The total force will be the force due to the solid sphere, that is g, mass of the solid sphere, mass of that particle which is put here, m dash, divided by distance from the center. Now distance from the center is x minus r whole square plus, again for the solid sphere, g mass of the solid sphere, mass of that particle divided by distance from the center of the solid sphere. Distance of the center of the solid sphere is x minus capital R whole square. These are the three parts where you can very easily identify that if you place a particle, then how much force it is going to experience at three different positions. Now look at this question 14 here. In question 14, they have given a uniform metal sphere of radius A and mass capital M. This is the metal sphere that is placed inside a spherical shell of mass capital M and radius 4a such that the metal sphere's surface touches the center of the shell. Please look at the figure that I tried to draw. The metal sphere touches the center of the shell. Now, distances they have given, they have taken two points, P1 and P2. Point P1 and point P2 are two points taken in such a way that P1 is at a distance A inside the shell and P2 is at a distance A outside the shell, distances measured from the boundary of this shell. So what we have to do? We have to find out the gravitational field at the point P1 and P2 as shown in the figure. This is just a CBAC model question. CBAC class 11 model question. Here, gravitational field at point P1. Who will generate field? Here, the shell will not contribute anything. It is because it is inside the shell. So, no contribution by the shell. Then who will generate the gravitational field? Only the sphere. And what do you see the distance of the point P1 from the center of the sphere? From the center of the sphere, the distance will be equal to. Let's see. This distance is A. And what is the radius of the shell? The radius of the shell is 4A. So therefore, this distance will be equal to 3A. Hence, what we can say, the gravitational field at point P1, it will be equal to G into mass of the sphere divided by distance square. What distance should I write? 4A square. So this becomes, let me then finalize the result. It will be G into M divided by 16A square. Is it not? Then what is the gravitational field at point P2? Here, both will generate gravitational field. And gravitational field will be in the same direction. No, it will be towards that sphere, towards that shell. Now, we should be very much aware of the distances. Please be careful about the distances. Now, gravitational field provided by the sphere, shaded portion, G into mass of the sphere divided by from the center of the sphere, what is the distance up to point P2? It is A plus 3A, 4A plus A, 5A plus A, 6A. So it will be 6A square plus the contribution by the shell now. What is the mass of the shell? M, same mass. So G into mass divided by distance from its own center square. From the center of the shell, the distance of P2 is 3A plus A plus A. That is 5A whole square. I am not writing the final result, that you can very easily ascertain the final result. This was to be done in this particular question. Now you see question number 15. In question number 15, they have said a thin spherical shell having uniform density is cut into two parts by a plane and kept separated as shown in the figure. And now they are taking two points. This is point A and this is point B. The centers of those circular faces are the center of the plane section of the first part and B is the center of the plane section of the second part. Show that the gravitational field A at A due to the first part is equal in magnitude to the gravitational field at B due to the second part. It is very easy. See, when the sphere or the shell rather, the shell was not cut. So what is the net gravitational field intensity inside the shell? Inside it will be zero. Now when you cut this shell into two parts, the gravitational field intensity at point B won't be zero because it is not a complete shell. There will be gravitational field intensity here. Let us say E. And at this particular point, which is the center of that, you can say the small part, it will be having a gravitational field intensity E. Is it not? So when you place, when the small part is again replaced over the other part so that the shell is completed. So that the shell is completed, then net value of E has to be zero. is it not? Because it becomes a complete shell. So net value of E has to be zero. So if I am taking that one part is kept over the other part, it becomes a complete shell. And if you take up this particular point, what is the net field? The net field is zero. And when the net field is zero, that means the field which this part was creating, this E, will have to be counterbalanced by the field which the other part was creating. This was the partition line along which they have been cut. So this question was asked like this, that show that these two fields are same. Logically, we don't have to solve anything. Logically, they are same, because ultimately when they are going to be placed over one another in order to complete the shell, the net gravitational field has to be zero. And in order to have to be zero, the each individual field created by the bigger one, this capital E, and created by the smaller one, this E, they have to be same in magnitude. Now look at question number 17. In question number 17, they have given three particles of mass m, each are placed at the three corners of an equilateral triangle, and each side is A. Then what they are doing is find the work done, or find the work that should have been done on this system to increase the sides of the triangle to 2A. That is, one system gets converted into the other system, only the size of the sides, their separation has increased. So they are asking what is the work done. I first find out what is the gravitational potential energy in the initial case. Please remember, gravitational potential energy is always negative, is it not? So minus, how many terms will be there in this first case? If you form pairs of these masses, you have three terms. So minus g into m by a, again minus g m into m by a, and again minus g m into m by a. This will be the initial gravitational potential energy. And final, when the triangle have grown to a side 2a, that is minus g, any two masses, m into m divided by side 2a, same thing again, three times we need to find out, is it not? The masses are m each. Then what is u final minus u initial? That is the change in the gravitational potential energy. This is equal to minus 3gm square divided by 2a, and again minus 3gm square divided by a. This change in the gravitational potential energy is the work done by the external agent, external work done. So external work done will be equal to 3gm square by a, if you take common, 1 minus half. So this becomes 3gm square divided by 2a. This is the work done in increasing the distance. This work is done, you should know that this work is done by the external agent against the system's internal gravitational attraction among the particles. So the external agent have to fight against this gravitational pull among the particles in order to make them a little apart from one another. That is, in order to increase the distance between the particles. Now let us see question number 36. In question 36, it is given find the minimum co-latitude which can directly receive a signal from a geostationary satellite. So let us first quickly have a review of what is geostationary satellite. A geostationary satellite, you remember we have discussed, it is always in the equatorial plane. And what is the height above this Earth's surface? It is 36,000 kilometers. And what is the radius of this Earth? Although it is 6400 kilometers, we can take it as around 6,000 kilometers. So from the center of the Earth, how far the geostationary satellite is? 36,000 plus 6,000, that is 42,000 kilometers. Now let us read the language of the question what they have given. They are asking that find the minimum co-latitude which can directly receive a signal from a geostationary satellite. That means if you see that this is the axis of rotation of this planet, that is basically the Earth. And if I draw a tangent from the geostationary satellite to this Earth, so up to this point, not beyond this, up to this point from the equatorial region, these points can directly receive the signal from the geostationary satellite. And if I take, again I am drawing the figure because it is purely figure based question what they have asked. Look at the geometry of this structure. The geometry of the structure will see that, see, we have a point that we recognized at this particular location and we joined it to the center, and this is the latitude phi. If this is the latitude phi, so this will be equal to alpha. So here, if phi is the latitude of that point which we are talking about, then this angle alpha, which is equal to 90 degree minus phi, this is the co-latitude. This is the co-latitude of that point. This is the co-latitude of that point. So what the question of question number 36, they are asking, find the minimum co-latitude. Minimum means we cannot have less than that. If we take it less than that, then what happened? The signal won't be reaching. If this is point N, this is point A, we have already drawn a tangent at this point A, this is B. So what are these values? This is already I mentioned, this is 42,000 kilometers. And this is 6400 kilometer, around 6400 kilometer the radius is. So what can we find out from here? We can first of all find out the cos theta or sine theta, is it not? So what is cos phi? Cos phi will be equal to 6400 divided by 42,000. So it comes out to be 16 by 106, that is 8 by 53. So how much this is? Phi will be cos inverse 8 by 53, is it not? Now it should be alpha they are asking, is it not? So alpha is equal to pi by 2 minus cos inverse 8 by 53 is very nearly 0.15, and I hope from the inverse trigonometrical ratios you have got the idea that pi by 2 minus cos inverse 0.15 is nothing but sine inverse 0.15. So this angle alpha that they were asking, that is sine inverse 0.15. Then let's see question number 37. A particle is fired vertically upward from the Earth's surface. From the Earth's surface, a particle is fired vertically up. I think speed is not given. Let us say the speed is u. And it goes up to a maximum height of 6400 kilometers. That is a maximum height of 6400 kilometers it is going. And therefore, from 6400, it is turning back. It will return back because of the Earth's pull. So what they are asking is find the initial speed of the particle. So initial speed of the, here we will be doing simply the energy conservation, is it not? That will be our objective to find out. So let u is equal to initial speed of the particle. So if u is the initial speed of the particle, then what is the total energy just at the moment it is thrown? It is half m u square minus, and the gravitational potential energy of the system G capital M small m divided by capital R, where capital R is the radius of the Earth. And when it is very, very far away, then what is this 6400? Can you recognize? This is also the radius of the Earth, is it not? So the R plus H will be just 2R. R plus H will be equal to 2R because this is R. So what is the total distance from the center up to which the particle goes? It is R plus H, that is 2R. So exactly at the moment when it just turns back, its kinetic energy will be zero. The gravitational potential energy is minus GMM divided by 2R. Now it seems to be easy, is it not? So just take these terms to the other side and we will be in a position that is half u square. I just cancelled small m. So this is equal to gm by r minus gm by 2r. That is basically gm by 2r. So from there u square is equal to 2 times gm by 2r, and u will be root over this. So finally it is equal to root over gm by r. Let us put the value. Too much calculation is there. 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11, and mass of the Earth is very nearly 6 into 10 to the power 24, and radius of the Earth in SI units, it is very nearly 6400 into 10 to the power 3. So finally, the U value comes out to be 0.8 or 0.79 into 10 to the power 4 meter per second, or it is 79 kilometer per second is the initial speed with which it has to be thrown vertically up. Then look at question number 38. In question 38, they are asking a particle is fired vertically upward with a speed of 15 kilometer per second, similar to the previous question, but there the speed is given as 15 kilometer per second. So what will happen by looking at this? It simply reveals that it goes to infinity. Will it return back to the Earth's surface? No, because it has already exceeded the escape velocity. Is it not? It is exceeded escape velocity. So what they are asking is, see the language of the question, with what speed it will move in interstellar space? Interstellar space means when it is quite far away. Let v is the speed in interstellar space, that is at infinity when it is far away from this. Here what I am trying to do, I will be using energy conservation. So half mu square, and at the surface from where it is thrown, minus gmm by r. And after a long time when it reaches infinity, this gravitational effect will be negligible. It will be only moving with some kinetic energy. So this v, they are asking with what speed it will be moving. So v square is equal to u square by 2 minus g capital M by r. And from there, we can calculate after putting the value of v. I hope now we will be in a position to do. After putting all the values, v finally comes out to be 1.01 into 10 to the power 4 meter per second. That is 10 kilometer per second. That is the speed in interstellar space. Now you see question 32. This is a CBSE or NEET model question. It will be useful for the school examination as well. In question 32, they are saying a satellite of mass 1000 kg is supposed to orbit the Earth. So if this is the Earth and there is a satellite of mass, very heavy mass, not very heavy, 1000 kg it is given. Still it is, that means it is quite heavy, and it is orbiting the Earth. Now the distance they have given is 2000 kilometer above the Earth's surface. That means this distance, this height is equal to 2000 kilometer. And this is the radius of the Earth as usual. is 6400 kilometers. So what they are asking now? We have to find out the speed in its orbit, the kinetic energy, the potential energy of the Earth satellite system, and the time period is also asked. Mass of the Earth is 6 into 10 to the power 24 as per the data that is available here. Now let us see. We have already done the orbital velocity is how much? Orbital velocity is root over gm by small r. Here small r is equal to r plus h. Is it not? Just put the value 6.67 10 to the power minus 11. What is the mass of the Earth? They have given as mass of the Earth is, let me see the data. This is 6 into 10 to the power 24, and R is equal to 6400, and this height is equal to 2000. These are in kilometers. So into 10 to the power 3. So after putting all the values, we get the orbital speed is equal to 6.9 into 10 to the power 3 meter per second, or it is 6.9 kilometer per second, quite heavy speed. Then kinetic energy of the satellite. The kinetic energy of the satellite is equal to half. Mass of the satellite is 1000 kg they have given, and velocity square means 6.9 into 10 to the power 3 square. So it comes out to be 2.38 into 10 to the power 10 joule. Then they have asked the potential energy of the Earth satellite system. So gravitational potential energy is always negative. Please remember G, mass of the Earth into mass of the satellite divided by R plus H, the distance between their centers. After putting all these values, 6.67 10 to the power, minus 11, and mass of the Earth 6 into 10 to the power 24, satellite's mass is 10 to the power 3, which is 1000 kg they have given. And this is 6400 plus 2000. It is in kilometers, so multiply by 10 to the power 3. So it finally comes out to be minus 4.76 into 10 to the power 10 joule. This is the gravitational potential energy of the Earth satellite system. And they are also asking the time period. Now, time period of the satellite. The time period, you remember, time period is equal to 2 pi total distance, how much it moves, r plus h, divided by the orbital speed, is it not? So time period is equal to 2 into 3.14, and within bracket that is 8400 kilometer means 10 to the power 3, and orbital speed, how much we calculated that time, 6.9, is it not? And 10 to the power 3 was also there. So after putting all these values, we will be getting 76.6 into 10.2, and it is this much seconds we will get. So it is very nearly 2.1 hour. You can check the calculations. Now see question 29. It is given that the time taken by the Mars to revolve around the Sun is 1.88 years. That is, time period for Mars is equal to 1.88 years. Now, question here arises, which year? Year means every planet will have different years. This is called Earth year. That is the year that we know in our knowledge. Then in that regards, the time period for the Earth to move round the Sun will be equal to 1 year. Is it not? That is, you can say 1.88 years in our view will be 1 year in the Mars point of view. I hope you got this idea what I mean to say. Because year, there is no absolute measurement of year. What we understand from our point of view is on the basis of the Earth's rotation around the Sun. So this data is given. what we need to find out? Find the ratio of the average distance between the Mars and the Sun, so that between the Earth to that of the between the Earth and the Sun. Okay, that means average distance. Here, average distance is nearly the radius of their orbits round the Sun. And you remember, this is heliocentric model. In heliocentric model, I told that the Earth is, the Sun is considered to be the center of the solar system. And as per the Kepler's law, according to Kepler's law, T square is proportional to R cube. Is it not? Which law it is? It is the third law, Kepler's third law, you remember? So we have T for the Mars divided by T for the Earth. I am taking the ratio square will be equal to R for the Mars divided by R for the Earth whole to the power 3. So as per their logic, let us see that the radius for the Mars divided by the radius for the Earth is equal to T for the Mars, which is 1.88 years, and T for the Earth, which is 1 year, this to the power 2 by 3. So this is 1.88 to the power 2 by 3, which is nearly equal to 1.52. This is what they have asked in this particular question. Then see question 21. They have given that the gravitational field in a region is given by vector E is equal to 2i plus 3j SI units. SI units means Newton per kg. Show that no work is done by the gravitational field when the particle is moved along the line. Now, the particle is moved along the line whose equation they have given is 3y plus 2x is equal to 5. Here, it is very easy to understand that what is the slope of the line along E? The slope of the line is equal to, you can directly see that, tan inverse 3 by 2. And what is the slope of this line? The slope of the line is equal to tan inverse minus 2 by 3. So what you understand from there is that these two lines are perpendicular. Is it not? They are perpendicular. That is, the direction of E is in one direction and the direction in which the particle is shifted is in the other direction. Just roughly speaking, you can see that if this is the gravitational field, then the direction in which the particle is shifted is along the perpendicular to this direction is in this direction. It is displacement. So gravitational force will be always acting in this direction and displacement is perpendicular to the gravitational force. Therefore, work done will be zero because we don't need to fight against any force which is along the direction of the displacement. That is what the language of the question that has been asked in this. Now let us see question number 28. Here, you just read the question properly. A pendulum having a bob of mass m hanging in a ship sailing along the equator from east to west. See, this is the Earth. And I hope you are aware of, from your general knowledge, that the Earth is rotating from west to east. Earth rotates from west to east. Let us say Earth's rotational speed is like this. And this is the equator along which a ship is sailing, some ocean will be there, a ship is sailing. Now, in which direction the ship is sailing? It is sailing from east to west. From east to west, along this direction. It is sailing. Now, when the ship is stationary with respect to water, the tension in the string is T0. When the ship does not sail, that means it just remains stationary. So, if it is remaining stationary, that means it is moving in a circular path only due to the rotational speed of the earth. So, at that moment, they are saying that the tension in the string is T0. The tension in the string is T0. Okay. Then, what we can say? What is the, find the speed of the ship due to rotation of the earth about its axis. So, speed of the ship. Again, properly read the language of the question. Find the speed of the ship due to rotation of the earth about its axis. Speed of the ship due to rotation of the earth. It will be how much? It will be simply omega r. It is only due to the movement of the earth. The ship does not have its own motion with respect to the earth. And at that moment, they are saying the tension is T0. So, earth is pulling. Just imagine you are inside the ship. And when you are inside the ship, from your ship's ceiling, that room ceiling, some pendulum is hanging. So, if you draw the free body diagram of that pendulum, what do you understand? Earth will be definitely pulling this mg. And there will be tension T0. So what is, and in due course of this, the ship is moving in a circular path. Is it not? If the ship is moving in a circular path, then of course you can say the net force towards the center of the earth will be nothing but mg minus T0. Is it not? Mg minus T0. And that is equal to mv square, v means omega r square divided by r. This is what we need to find out. Now, what is the second part of the question? Find the difference between T0 and the Earth's attraction of the bob. So, the difference is between the Earth's attraction and T0. Between the Earth's attraction and T0, what difference can you justify here? The difference is mg minus T0 is m omega square r square by r is r. So, this m omega square r, this is what the difference they are asking. And in the third part, what he is saying is, if the ship sails at a speed v, so if the ship sails at a speed v, of course, with respect to the earth, is it not? So then, what is the effective speed then? Effective speed will be v minus omega r. It is sailing and the earth is taking it back because of the opposite rotation. So under that case, he is asking that what is the tension in the string? What is the tension in the string? Again, if you draw the free body diagram, then what can you understand that? Mg minus the new value of tension will be equal to m and v minus omega r square divided by r. This is what you can think here. That means mg minus t is this. From there, let me see that t is equal to this tension they are asking. Mg minus, is it not? T is equal to mg minus m by r, and this whole square let us do. The whole square is equal to v square plus omega square r square minus 2v omega r. And then let's finalize. This is equal to mg minus mv square by r minus m omega square r plus 2m r omega. 2m r omega. R is, of course, capital letter. We can use it. It's not small letter. It is capital letter. Just check the term that I have written. So t is equal to, let me see what was T0. From our earlier discussion, from here what is T0? T0 is equal to mg minus m omega square r. Just recognize mg minus m omega square r. I hope we can write t naught in place of this. So this is t naught minus mv square by r plus 2m r omega. Now the term which is mv square by r, this particular term is quite negligible. Why? It is because we are dividing by capital R. V is just a small velocity, how much velocity with which a ship sails. So this is just negligible. So here what we get is T is equal to T naught plus 2m r omega approximately. This much is the tension in the thread, tension in the wire at that moment when the ship is sailing at a speed V. Now let us see question number 26. A body stretches a spring by a particular length at the Earth's surface at the equator. So at the equator, what is the effective value of G? It is G dash is equal to G minus omega square R. And for stretching, mg dash should be equal to k delta x. So therefore, delta x should be equal to mg dash divided by k. So here we should remember that extension will be proportional to the effective value of acceleration due to gravity. So greater the value, greater will be the extension. Less the value, less will be the extension. They are asking at what height above the South Pole will it stretch the same spring at the same length. That means above the South Pole, let us say H is the height above the South Pole, what will be G dash? The G dash above the South Pole is almost very nearly equal to G into 1 minus 2H by R, assuming. You remember we have discussed this formula not to be reliable, assuming H is very, very less than R. So for same extension of spring, you just put G dash is equal to G double dash. When you put G dash is G double dash, so G minus omega square R is equal to G into 1 minus 2H by R. So they are asking about the height, I hope so. G gets cancelled, is it not? So when you cancel G, just divide by G. So 1 minus omega square R by G, this is 1 minus 2H by R. From here, H can be calculated. That is omega square R square divided by 2G. You put the proper units and values. It is 11125 meters. And it finally comes out to be very nearly 10 kilometer. Nearly, that is very nearly above the South Pole of height 10 kilometer, the same extension of the spring can be expected.